It's our time with Scott Ryan. I am your host, Scott Ryan. It's kind of where I got the name of the show. Pretty good. And it's fun to have a guest who knows where It's Our Time comes from. So that's good. Today we're going to be speaking with Em Marinelli, who wrote Comfort Sequels. And I'm sure there's a subtitle that has the word 80s and 90s in it. What is the subtitle?
The subtitle is The Psychology of Movie Sequels from the 80s and 90s.
Did you have to look at the book or you knew that?
I did. No, I'm just kidding. I remembered. I just wanted to hold up my coffee too. Right. So we were twinsies.
So welcome to the show. How are you today?
I'm doing great. Thanks for having me. I'm excited to talk about Comfort Sequels.
So let's start with the most important sequel, which is the shirt you're wearing. Grease 2 is better. Now, this is such a funny, controversial, fake thing that people have is the battle between Grease and Grease 2.
Yeah.
Do other movies have that? Because I kind of think this is the only one. But I mean, is there really a battle between Ghostbusters and Ghostbusters 2?
I don't think so. I think it's just like widely accepted that people don't like Ghostbusters 2, mostly. Mostly. Now, the sequels after that in the franchise, I think, have gotten more like Afterlife and Frozen Empire. People love them. But Ghostbusters 2 is like, no, I don't think so. But yeah, Grease 2, there's definitely like a, it didn't do well. It was competing with E.T. It just didn't stand a chance. And then later on, when it comes on syndication and then on VHS, and like when I was younger, then it became a cult classic. Like people started understanding it and loving it and being like, wait a second, this is so much better than the original.
Yeah, I know. And it really is.
It is.
But let's break it down.
Okay.
With no emotion, like not.
Oh, okay. That's good. That'll be easy for me.
Not like why we like it because it's our childhood, but like if you look at it as a piece of film, the story of Grease is horrible, right? I mean, it's literally horrible. Oh, what should the girl do to get the boy? Change herself completely.
Yeah.
But Grease 2, tell us what the story is of Grease 2, which is one of the things you point out in the interviews and as well as your essay to sort of prove this point of the difference between Grease and Grease 2.
Well, in Grease, they both change, right? So he, like, you know, is trying to. I mean, he's trying, they're trying to meet in the middle a little bit.
That is not true. As soon as she shows up in the hot pants, he
yeah, that's
off
true.
And he's like,
he doesn't
hey,
care.
Really,
it's so
thing.
True. It's so true. You're right.
She keeps the leather on. She doesn't pull her leather pants off.
It's true. Well, why would you do that? No, you would not do that. That is the greatest outfit ever. I mean, I have so much like love for Olivia Newton-John. But Grease 2 is a gender reversal story. And Michelle Pfeiffer, who plays Stephanie Zanoni, is the protagonist of the movie, and she's not willing to change at all. She kisses who she wants when she wants. She's also like very much kind of expanding what femininity means. So she like works at a gas station / auto mechanic place. She wears pants to school in 1961, and then she realizes like, oh my gosh, I could get expelled. I like better put on a skirt before I go to class. I mean, she's just like going way outside of the box in terms of like what is acceptable and what is okay. And she says, I want a cool writer. And that's it. I want a life of adventure. I want a life of travel. I want a whole lot more than the boy next door. She doesn't want that kind of 50s housewife archetypal, you know, white picket fence situation. She wants a cool writer, and she's not willing to accept anything less. It's like change and be a cool writer, or find me and be a cool writer. Cool writer, find me, and we will go off into the sunset together. Or don't, or leave me alone. I'm going to just have a hamburger with a lot of ketchup on it. And that's what happens. Now, Maxwell Caulfield, who's in love with her, who is a nerd, who I interviewed, who's wonderful, he does change for her. He, I think, taps into a part of himself that is this kind of cool writer, this kind of other, I don't know, shadow part or something that comes out. And he basically becomes like a professional motorcycle stuntman overnight. in the course of the movie, going from never having ridden a motorcycle before to like becoming this incredible, cool writer. And then he finds her, and that's it. She doesn't change for him. Now, I don't love the idea of anybody having to change fundamentally who they are to be loved by anybody else. But I don't think that's totally what happens here, because at the end of the day, she's like, oh, you're Michael. You are this guy I know who is a Shakespeare nerd and is really smart and, all of these other things. You play the piano. And also, now you're a cool writer. So now we can get together. It's pretty badass.
Yeah, I mean, the story is so much better, and I think it's kind of like the difference between liking pop music and then liking alternative music. Like the songs in Greece are just so poppy. It doesn't mean they're bad, but are they really outside of Hopelessly Devoted to You, which is not technically, it is in
It's
the
not in the
movie, it's
show.
not in the show. Songs are actually not plot driven songs where Greece 2 is. So I think that's interesting. Now, your book is about more than just like busting the plot points of 80s crap movies. There are two extra pillars to your book, one being the therapeutic side of finding comfort, and the other being how this movie weaved its way into your childhood. For that side, I want to talk about Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles Part 2, The Turtles Eat Pizza.
The Secret of the Ooze. You
I
have to say the
don't know.
subtitle.
I didn't
I
even
love
know the
movies that
subtitle
have,
here.
I love sequels that have like a subtitle. It's like they're taking themselves so seriously. Like Mannequin 2 On the Move is actually a funny, I'll just tell you a quick story about that, which is that there is no secret. Like the secret part of the ooze was like that the mutation came from some sort of alien component. And it was cut from the movie, but they left the subtitle in. I thought it was great.
Well,
There's
it
actually
was
no
a secret.
secret.
No, it's actually a secret.
It's a real secret.
It's so secret that
It's
you're
so
ooh.
secret.
That's the way it actually works. So, I think one of the things about this book that is really fascinating is I will be honest with you, I have not seen a moment of any mutant turtle. It didn't it I was older when they came, and I know nothing about the mutants, but this was my favorite one that you connected to your life, how you weaved this movie in. Can you give us a little bit of how you did that? Like, so you knew you wanted to cover this movie, and then you're going to connect it to your life. Tell people like sort of what how it connects to your life, but then also like how you sort of did that, like how you came up with that concept.
When I started writing this book, I was like, oh, there's a story here from my childhood that relates to this movie. Let me try to write that story and see what happens. And I wrote it, but I was like, no, this book is about psychology and it's about behind the scenes stuff and it's about production and about these movies, these sequels that provided me comfort from my childhood. I shouldn't lean too heavily on stories from my childhood. Who am I? Do people want to read this? Who cares? But every single time that I would do it, I would get more in touch with what the movie meant to me. And I would get feedback from people that I would share the stories with and say, your memoir part is the best part of this chapter. Like, you should roll with this and see what occurs. And so naturally, it started unfolding that a movie like Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles 2, The Secret of the Ooze, is it wasn't just about, when I saw the movie and what was going on in my life, but it reminded me of, a person that my mom dated when I was at that age who taught me all about sort of nature and taught me about kind of like the ooze of like what like climate change and all of these different ways that like capitalism and have like mutated the earth and changed the earth. And he's teaching me about all this environmental stuff that's going on during this time I'm watching this movie at his house. And so it just became this beautiful, natural story that, unfolded along the way. And the themes around, returning to the earth and returning to the natural world and getting away from ooze, mutation, capitalism, greed, corporate grossness, just kind of found its way in. The other thing that found its way in this chapter is I had a lot of, this is a personal thing that's in the book. I had a lot of characters in my life that were, abusive people who were, especially people that my mom dated or married. And this was a guy who was not that. This was a really wonderful character in my life who was supportive and loving. And I thought about this idea of, well, when we're surrounded by people, caregivers who are supportive and loving and attuned and take care of us, what does that mean in terms of nurturing? And there's these two kind of monsters in the movie, Toka and Rezar, and they're born of the bad guys. And so they're raised by the bad guys. And they come out and they're like, Daddy, Mama. And then because they're raised by the bad guys, they like turn into these terrible monsters. And I was thinking about these like sweet characters, because of the, spoiler alert for anybody who's like dying to see this movie now that we're talking about it, or loves Teenage Mutant Turtles, who hasn't seen it, but they love the turtles. But just to say that they at the end sort of like collapse back into their baby selves, and then they're so little and innocent. And it's like, oh, right, what happens when you have positive caregivers in your life, positive influences, positive role models, people that teach you things and actually care about you? And I folded that in too, and it all just made a lot of sense.
Well, I think it helps
Yeah,
for
go ahead.
people who are like, well, why do I want to read about movies I've never seen or aren't the top echelon of the greatest art that mankind has produced in the 20th century? Well, the thing is that I think that anyone can relate with is when you're a kid, you consume what's in front of you. You don't really like, you're not objective about the movies you watch. You sort of watch what's there, and then whatever's going on in your life gets eaten up with that as well. So I think anyone can relate with that. It's so fascinating to me because we're living in a time where all we have is sequels and reboots and the most benign things. And at the same time, everyone looked down at sequels in the 80s. And you say sequels bring us comfort. Let's move to the third part of your book, which is the therapeutic part of it. Why? Why do we find comfort in sequels? And is that, despite that all these movies bombed, except maybe Batman Returns, we now live in a time of only sequels. Is that why? So I'm throwing you this two-part question.
I think the second part about this time, this particular moment, is I think more about like what is selling and that there's not a lot of tons of new interesting stories being told in, big studios. It's just like, oh, this made money. This Marvel movie made money. Let's do more of it and more and more and more. And to me, that feels different than My Girl 2. My Girl 2, the continuing story of Veda, is comforting for me. I'm excited to see what happens to her in adolescence and coming of age stuff and her mood rings, and I wear mood rings, and her first kiss, real first kiss, I would say, on the tarmac, and that paralleled with my first kiss. And so I think what's comforting is seeing characters that we grow to feel like are part of our family come back, and what is their next chapter? And it made me think about what is my next chapter? And maybe helped me escape a little bit about, moments and times in my childhood that were overwhelming, that were traumatic, that were chaotic. Sequels are stable. They're predictable. A lot of times it's like a recycled plot from the first movie, just kind of done a little bit differently with the same people. That is familiar. What is
So,
predictable and familiar, especially for, I think, young kids, can
do
be
you
really comforting.
consider what's going on with the Marvel Universe or the DC universe, are those sequels? Do you consider those sequels?
Oh no, I haven't seen a lot of them, to be
But it's
honest with you.
interesting what you're
But
saying, what you
it
just
could be.
described to
Yeah.
me sounds like why all these people want to go see Spider-Man 75.
Sure. Yeah.
Spider-Man's gonna he's gonna shoot his web at someone. I know he's gonna shoot his web. I know there's gonna be a scene where the webs don't work. Oh, they found a thing, the webs don't work, but then he found a thing that got the thing that made the webs not work work. And we know what's gonna happen from the
Yeah.
start to the finish. That God, that's what we want.
I think it's what some people want. And I don't just want this. Let me be clear. I also am interested in really, compelling storytelling that mostly happens with like independent films or whatever. Like, I'm interested in other things too, but in terms of returning to something that's nostalgic and familiar, getting immersed into a film. I talk about the psychological concept called transitional objects, which are objects that the kind of a, I'm going to go psychology for a second. Okay. That babies have or infants have that transition them from their caregiver to the outside world, which is scary and overwhelming. So they can take a part of the parent with them or the caregiver with them and take and go to the outside world. So those are things like pacifiers or blankets or teddy bears, something that's comforting and familiar. And I think that in terms of nostalgia today and what a lot of people are looking for in fandom is like, we have those transitional objects. They come in the form of action figures, or they come in the form of like t-shirts, or I have tattoos of, things that I love all over my body. Twin Peaks tattoos, for example. We take what we love with us into the outside world. That happens, I think, in fandom everywhere. And so I think there is a crossover with what's happening now in comfort and nostalgia and fandom and what I'm sort of purporting in the book. But for me, and the reasons why, like big franchises like Back to the Future and Lethal Weapon and those things aren't included in my book, even though they were huge and huge sequels. I mean, those sequels made money, is that they weren't comforting for me specifically. And what was comforting for me is not comforting for everybody. Not everybody is going to be comforted by The Great Muppet Caper, although I don't see how you could not be. But some people are not, and that's fair. I mean, Miss Piggy is fierce. Kermit's amazing. How could you not? The songs are Happiness Hotel. Couldn't we ride? They're riding bicycles. The Muppets are riding bicycles. And this is before CGI. Like, that is amazing. Just from a puppeteer standpoint, like, how do they do that? I mean, it's fascinating. And the singing is comforting and the characters are comforting. I want Fozzie Bear. I want Gonzo. I love it. So those things are comforting for me and not for everyone. And that's fair. And Spider-Man is comforting for some folks. And that's fair. And that's great. What do you love? And do you want to consume it? And do you want to consume more of it? And I'm somebody who wants to consume a lot of it over and over again.
You mentioned Twin Peaks, and Twin
Oh.
Peaks had a comeback, a return, a reboot, whatever you want to call it, with Twin Peaks The Return. It is most definitely not a comfort sequel. In fact, it goes out of its way to provide any comfort whatsoever. But you love it.
Yeah.
So, how do you balance that? When you could not say that Mark Frost and David Lynch provided any comfort within the return.
It's true. The whole return is about frustrating your demand to want to go back to Twin Peaks, right? It's like the message is you can't go back. Trauma doesn't allow you to go back. So you have to just go to all of these other places and then wake up or try to wake up and then you're gonna go to a different dimension somewhere else. Yeah, you're right. And yet, because of my relationship to the show and to Fire Walk With Me, seeing the same characters, being in the world of Lynch and Frost creates a certain sense of nostalgia and connection and comfort. Even though, right, the first time I saw it in 2017, I was just like, every time I was like screaming at the TV, like, where's Audrey? Like, I can't, what's happening? Like, it's so upsetting. And yet it still connects me to those worlds. And so there's something comforting in that familiarity, even though it's completely different.
Interesting.
I'm curious about if other people feel that way too.
I don't
Not you,
see how.
obviously.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know how you could say that you're provided any amount of comfort, even all the way down to the music. Outside of the theme, I guess you hear the theme every time we see Laura Palmer's face, but Agent
No,
Cooper isn't
it's
in.
grossly
Oops.
uncomfortable. No, it's grossly uncomfortable, and it's meant to be, and it's important that it is. I'm just saying, for me personally, there's something that anchors me and ties me back to the show that I love so much and that is comforting for me. And just to say, and we've talked about this before too, but just to say even that the first and second season of Fire Walk With Me is comforting is a weird thing to say.
Right. But then that sequel. I mean, neither of them are
No,
sequels, so we're not
that's
really
true.
talking about
It's
continuing
a
the story
prequel.
and
You're right.
giving us the same thing where it's
That's true.
literally called Twin Peaks: The Return. One could argue whether they wanted to call it that or not. There's a whole lot of debate about that, but I just wanted to bring it up as a topic because I was curious as someone who has literally written the book on comfort. And I know you love it. It's just that it's almost like against
It
everything you're
is.
preaching. But we look forward to whatever you come up with next. The book is so well written, it's so readable. It doesn't matter what the films are, you get caught up in it. And people can go to tuckerdspress.com, and the book is available at your local bookstore and on Amazon. Where can people follow you or find out more about you?
Thanks. They can you can find me at Em's Marinelli on Instagram and Facebook, and emsmarinelli.com as well.
And the best song in Greece, too, is.
I think it's We'll Be Together. That's what I'm gonna say for today.
All right, that's
What's
that.
what about for you? You have to answer that question as well.
I would say it's definitely Let's Do It for Our Country, but what are you gonna do? Well, thank you so much for having us. I don't know if you had us.
No, you had me. Thanks for having me.
Oh, there we go. Yeah, so it was your job to thank me. Thanks for being a great guest, and we look forward to what you do next.
Thanks, Matt.
All right, well, that was our time with Scott Ryan, and we'll see you next time.